Okay, well, thank you, Carol, for inviting me to do this presentation. The name of the presentation is Impact of Emerging Technologies, and my name is Luis Garcia. I'm the Vice President of Emerging Technologies at Full Sail University. Let's get started. In my role as Vice President of Emerging Technologies, I'm very lucky to have the opportunity to travel many corners of the world to the most important technology companies and gaming studios in the US and abroad. And with that, my travels have taken me to places like Google and Blizzard and Facebook, Riot, Epic Games, and so on. Carol, you said that your son plays Fortnite, is that right?
Yeah, he loves playing Fortnite.
Yes. So Fortnite is actually built by a company called Epic Games in North Carolina. And I was able to visit, I think about a year ago, many Full Sail graduates working at Epic Games, and which not only do Fortnite, but they also develop what is called the Unreal Engine. Which is a 3D real-time graphics engine that is used in many AAA games and other industries, even in filmmaking. A lot of the backgrounds for the Disney series, The Mandalorian, for Star Wars, were done with Unreal Engine. So this gives me a lot of perspective about what's happening and what's coming for the world of technology. How's that going to affect our lives? But my journey with technology is a very long one. It started a very long time ago. So I'll start with that. I was born in the 1970s, in the early 1970s, in a city called Caracas, Venezuela. Which you can see the picture that in there. And I was also very lucky because I was born as part of a twin set. And I have an identical twin, which you can see in the picture. And I also like to ask people, I'm going to have to ask only Carol, if you can recognize me in that picture. Which one is me?
I've seen this picture before and I don't remember.
But that's terrible.
I'm going to guess you are the one smiling.
Give me the color of the shirt.
The
is it white or not?
Blue, no, the blue and red one.
I'm so sorry, Carol. You should have a better memory. I'm actually the one with the white shirt.
Come on, okay.
Yeah, well, here's the thing about having twins that a lot of people have misconceptions about, specifically about identical twins, which are more rare than fraternal twins. So I'll start my presentation by demystifying some of those things. Number one, I can't read his mind. For more than I wish, I can't. And I cannot feel his presence or predict what's gonna happen to him. He can't do the same with me either. And I cannot feel what he feels. So I'm sorry to break it up to you. Those are feelings that they were close to you, but unfortunately we can't do any of those things. So moving on, my journey of technology started in the 80s, in the early 80s. And I remember this one day in 1982, I was 10 years old and we were around the city with my dad. I don't remember, might have been a Saturday or Sunday. And my dad was talking about computers and how it was possible now that people could have computers in their homes. Because he had seen an ad in the paper of selling personal computers, and that's something that really impacted him. Because in his mind, the computers he knew were these very large machines, like the picture in the right, that's an IBM 360. A computer was a full room of machinery with several people working on it. And that's what my dad remembered as computers, as he worked in the computer lab in the 1960s when he went to college. Do you know how much storage that big computer could have, Carol?
You've told me before. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to guess 1 megabyte or 1 gigabyte.
Well, you got to make
I
got to
choose, right? 1 megabyte.
Yeah. 1 megabyte is correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's correct. The whole computer, which you use those tapes, it's the very the early ways to store data, have 1 megabyte, which is 1,024 kilobytes. And kilobytes, probably people are not familiar with, and megabytes is probably even less. So a megabyte is a gigabyte divided by 1,024. Now, to give you perspective on that number, I have this phone over here. I have an iPhone. You can see it, but it's close to my camera. But my iPhone can store 256 gigabytes, and which is 268,000 times more storage I can put in my phone than the whole room could store back then. So that's why my dad was so impressed about having a personal computer. So in this conversation, my dad asked us if we wanted to have a computer at home. And we thought of a computer kind of like a video game. So we said, sure, more games, one on. And I had to say that my dad brought home in 1976 a Pong machine, which is the first video game console produced for mass market. And in Venezuela in the 1970s, we did have a Pong machine. So this is an 82, so we've been familiar with video games for a while. And so this machine was just the machine. It was not connected to the internet, and it did not have a monitor. You need to connect it to the TV, and that was it. It could store 400K of in RAM memory, which is fairly nothing. And the store that sold it to us also sold us a course for programming. In a programming language called BASIC. And so we signed up for the course as well. And so that's when I started programming, about when I was about 10 years old. And after that, every summer, instead of going to summer camps, we used to go to a computer coding camps and for many years to come. And that's when I started in technology. And it was still the birth of perhaps the first big technology revolution. The idea of the personal computer is the first time that we get a very big breakthrough in computing technology for the masses in the 1980s. So we call that the first computer, the first technology revolution. Now, today, we thought back then that because computers have been so accessible that a lot of problems were solved and the world was going to be a lot better. And it has been a lot better, and there have been a lot of problems we have solved because of computers. But we also have very big challenges in the world. And 30 years later today, we have problems like climate change, like universal access to education, chronic disease, overpopulation of cities. And all these problems are very big and very complex. And technology can play a very important role into solving all of these problems. Because of the combination of technologies that are available today. So I just want to give you one example here of combining technologies to solve complex problems to make life better. At Full Sail University, we have a program called Positive Impact, where we use technology to improve the lives of people with limited abilities. In this particular case is for cerebral palsy. Now, I'm not an expert in cerebral palsy, but what I know of it is that it attacks children and it makes children have a lot of limitations with motility, to be the ability to move. It's really hard for some of them to even be able to stand up or keep their head straight. And so they use this very old technology, practically a ladder, to help train to strengthen their muscles. And they brought that to us to see if we can improve it. And our faculty and our technology programs came out with this. So I'm going to leave you with the video.
Assistive technology aims to improve the lives of people living with disabilities. In the simulation and visualization program, we ask students in the Portfolio 6 course to put their hardware and software skills to use towards a positive cause. The idea is, if anybody struggles with daily activities, what can we do to try and help them? And it's also partly just looking into the community instead of trying to, you know, come up with some epic project, just looking down the street and see what's around here so we can participate in the local community. CICO is a facility down the street here that works with kids with cerebral palsy and a whole range of motor disabilities and things like that.
It's so important for me to give success for these kids because they lose it in very early ages. Started with like, I cannot roll over, I cannot reach for my toy, but I want to. But I think I can. We can hear, we can change their life and make them as independent in their own life as possible.
Their facility has lots of ladder devices like this because they use them for strength training and grip, climbing, walking. So when we toured their facility and realized that, we decided that's a good target. Let's see if we can try to digitize one of these and make it interactive.
It still works nice.
We gave the audio version to them just to play around with and see what they thought about it. And that alone had fantastic results. What they told us was a lot of these kids have trouble even lifting their neck, but when they were reaching up and pressing on it and it was making a sound, they were looking up to see what was going on. And that was a huge, huge win for the staff over there. They were very excited to see that. But once we got past the audio version, we put on a monitor and a little computer. So now we could do software development and start making games and tie it into our inputs. And that's where the potential just went through the roof. Students were involved in every aspect of it. In fact, we were doing things that I had never done, so it was new to all of us, a lot of it.
Some of the challenges that we faced when constructing it were some electrical issues. We had some issues with the wiring and the paint methods to detect if people were touching it. We got some false triggers, which was a real challenge.
Even putting our hand near it, it was triggering false positives, and that was no good. Once we got past that, it was not too many challenges and just a lot of fun.
They started out very simple. They would grab a piece of the ladder and the screen would change colors. And then as soon as we got that down, we started coming up with a lot of other different ideas. And then from there, once we got some feedback from CICO to say, you know, this is good, or, you know, maybe this isn't very good, we just went from there and eventually just built those blocks up until we had something that both of us were really proud of.
Something that some of my students and I have been working on for many months, and we made it to obviously look very similar to some of the devices you have here, these ladders. And we looked at some of the activities that you do and tried to make them into more like a game, a computer version where we can interact and get feedback. So does anybody want to try this out?
It's so important for our kids to like get the technology closer to them because it's motivating them more. Almost all of our kids has an iPad at home. Now they have the motivation right in front of them. It gives us opportunity to develop head control, develop eye-hand coordination, develop holding grasp, and it's connected with a game which contains the opportunity to develop cognitive levels as well.
After we delivered the ladder, I got back and we started receiving pictures of the kids and the staff using it. And that's when it really kicked in. The smiles were so powerful.
A lot of the projects I had worked on previously usually involved some sort of training. It was really nice to see that there's just a totally different direction that the field can go.
Sometimes we just lose touch with connecting with people and helping out each other. And it's just like, do you need a helping hand? We can just help you with this stuff, make your life a little bit better.
For us, it was just work. But when you see the result of that and the smiles, that's when you realize you've done something much bigger than just worked on a project.
All right, so this is a great example of what is possible today, combining a lot of technologies and into something new that will have a tremendous impact on the lives of people. These are the places that we can go. This is how we can make exceptional contributions to the world. So I think we're gonna stop the first video here. Okay, so we just finished watching the video from Positive Cause at Full Sail. It's an example of technologies that could come together today to create something new and have a great impact. But back to the storyline we started before, in the 1990s, all of this was still a promise. And when I attended Full Sail University as a student in 1995, none of this was possible yet. So here I am again in this picture many years later. And so I had to ask Carol if she can recognize which one in this picture is me.
Oh my, here we go again. I think you are the one in the front.
This time you got it right.
Good. Okay, I'm happy.
Yeah, one on one. We got one right and one wrong. All right. So back then, computers were starting to interconnect in local networks and started to connect to the internet and in the wire network. And we had a lot of computer labs, like the one in the picture. In fact, that's an actual computer lab in the 90s at Full Sail University. Today, we actually don't have that many computer labs like those because students get laptops and they have a lot of power in those laptops. We do have some computer labs with very high-end computers that have a lot more capacity than the laptops. But for the most part, many of our computer labs are now gone. They're replaced with much more sophisticated computers. But back then, these powerful computers were able to combine text and music, sound and graphics, and video. And the combination of these things together inside the computers, what back then was called multimedia. When the internet started taking place and people started going online, it was very text-based. But you could see that this multimedia process was going to migrate to the internet eventually, which it did. And we wanted to be part of that process, of that revolution. So because in 1990s is when we get all this user base into the internet, interconnecting and interacting, exchanging information and so on, millions of people started doing that, is what we call today the second technology revolution, the internet. So the first revolution was the personal computer, and then about 10 years later, the ability of those computers to interconnect into a worldwide network called the internet is like the second revolution. So we wanted to be part of that as Full Sail students. So we knew that as international students, especially, it was very important that we were above and beyond what we were learning. It was very critical for us to be different, to have something to offer to employers that was very important to them because of the way the immigration laws work in the United States. You have to have a unique skill. So every day after class, we were do additional research on the internet, which was starting to take off, trying to familiarize ourselves into that new world and trying to understand what could we do that would get us in. And one day I remember my brother told me, I think I know what we need to learn. He's been reading this magazine that back then was an obscure magazine called Wired. And in fact, that a picture there of Wired is from the 1990s. And those are the founders of Yahoo, which was perhaps the most important internet company in the 90s. And he said, I think we have to learn a programming language called Java. That's what I'm reading, that most employers that are doing internet work are needing. So we went to the bookstore in the city in Orlando and bought ourselves a book in Java with a CD-ROM that had a Java compiler installed in our computers. And every day after class, we will teach ourselves this programming language. The second side of that, of trying to be part of this revolution and get employees, that we needed to make contacts. We needed to get to know people that already were in there. And back then, Full Sail used to attend some important industry events. And there was a very large one in Las Vegas every year called the National Association of Broadcasters, NAB. There's over 30,000 people that go there every year, and they made a competition to bring Full Sail students to it. And so we applied and competed and went through the selection process and got chosen to be part of the team that was going to represent Full Sail back then. That's what you see in the picture right there. And that was the group of students and staff and faculty that went to NAB 1996. And I won't try to ask you if you can find the Carol in the picture, because it's very small.
It's very small, but I know you can guide us to find where you are. I think I know where you are.
It's towards the middle, and towards the middle, there's this African American student, and we are right behind him to both sides of to his right and to his left.
You're both, right?
Yeah, the both of us are there. And I am the one to his left, to the left of the African American.
To his left. Okay, so I would have guessed it wrong.
You would have guessed wrong. There you go. So that's that. And in this convention, we were one of our staff members that used to train the instructors at Full Sail. And he came from the 3D industry. And he ran into a former client of his as he was getting into the conference. And this person was coming out of the conference. And they stopped by and have a quick conversation of how business was going. And he said, and this person he met. And remember, running into somebody is not that easy, because there's 30,000 people at five different locations in Las Vegas when this is happening. He said, well, we are doing a lot of work for ESPN, a lot of show openings and closings. So we got this great thing going on with ESPN, but they are in Connecticut and we're in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. So the production process is a little difficult. So we connected to the internet. We have a connection on a server, and I created a system for our animators to post their work and for the producers in Connecticut to give feedback in real time instead of being, you know, FedExing tapes and things like that. But because we did that, we started picking up new businesses for building websites. So we have a whole nother business we're in, but we need programmers. And do you know any programmers? And he turned around, you guys have your resume? And we're just ready with it. Yes, sir, here it is. And we gave him a resume, and a couple months later, they were flying us for an interview. So when we got to the interview, it was interesting because it wasn't a very conventional interview. But Andy was the name of the owner of the company. It's a young guy, just a few years older than us. And he said, well, I want to do this thing, and that I won't get you with the details, but it's basically something never been done. We needed to connect, create a system that connected the browser with the render farm. And he said, he has these books, here's this computer over here, here's all these books over there, here's the keys of the office, see you Monday. And then we just stayed in the office for the whole weekend building this thing, which was only possible to do in Java. And so that decision that we made many months before of learning this programming language really paid off. And then by Monday, he just walked in, turn on the computer in the theater. He had a theater in the office, and it's just trying and running it. And that's how we got our first job. Now, what is interesting about that is that wasn't unique to that moment. After we started that job, and for many years after, in other jobs afterwards, that became what we did, is building pieces of technology that didn't exist. And that's still true today. Now, the internet, let me give you a little overview of how impactful this has been. Back then, in the mid-1990s, there was only about 25 million people, and that sounds like a lot of people, and that was enough to get a lot of people excited. This new technology, the internet, allowed for new business models and new things. So one of the most famous ones was Netscape, who built the browser, the first browser. But then there are other companies like Yahoo, we mentioned that before, and the Amazon.com, it was called Amazon.com back then, and that's their logo right there, the second one there. That's the original logo, and Priceline and things like that. But you can tell how fast the user base was growing. A lot more people coming online meant a lot more people could shop, a lot of people would need information, things like that. And some of these companies started trading in the public markets and raising great amounts of money, which opened the opportunity to other people. So, but in that first group of companies led by Amazon.com was so popular that many other companies started coming up, and all of them with the .com. So there was Pets.com and EatToys.com. I worked for Kepasa.com, and a lot of those companies are still around. Many others are not. It's what they call the internet bubble. Eventually, many of those companies started failing. There wasn't enough market to sustain that. And some other things have really a sustainable business model. But the internet itself, even though a lot of those companies failed, the internet kept growing. So if you go 10 years later, so now you see the curve looks really small next to the next 10 years. When we started going half a billion users, 600 million users, and then with that amount of adoption, other business models started opening, and other companies started coming. Companies that now didn't just want to connect and give you information; they also wanted to connect people. So that's when Friendster came in, the first social network, and LinkedIn and MySpace, which became a huge social network. And which opened the door for Facebook and Twitter. All this was the model of connectivity or social internet, and that they came up because we were about a billion by the 2000s. There were a billion users on the internet. And when you get that kind of adoption, then you start disrupting traditional businesses like our industries, like commerce, finance, and even education. They're starting getting their transformation 10 years later because of the adoption. And then when we thought that they could not grow any faster, then look at how small the curve is now at Facebook and Twitter, where it gets to a 1 billion. It kept going once Apple introduced the first smartphone, the iPhone. And now with the amount of people connected, and the phone allowed to even have more people connected for more hours between the desktop and the phone. And this idea of social networking was very, very strong. So they opened the door to even more companies like WhatsApp, like Snapchat, like Instagram. There were companies that were born only because there was a smartphone with connectivity to the internet. All the way to 2014, one of the most famous today that you guys probably know as TikTok, but it started as Musical.ly. And at that point, we were reaching 3 billion users in 2014. Today, 10 years later after this, we just surpassed 4 billion users on the internet. So these have continued to grow in exponential scale. So this other era is what we call the third technology revolution, the social and mobile technology revolution, the ability to connect people and not only the information, but also the relationships. And I believe this is where we end the second video. Okay, so from our last video, we've ended with the third technology revolution, the social and mobile. We started with the first revolution, the personal computer. The second revolution was connecting those computers to the wide network or the internet. The third revolution was after people are connected, now they want to socialize them and then extending the connectivity from the PC to the smartphone. The third revolution called social and mobile. So where does that leave us today? So today we have a very interesting moment because something that never happened before in technology, and it is that there are technologies that have been in development for the past 20 and 30 years that are all getting to maturity, but that, which means widespread adoption, low cost to access them at the very same time. So we have things like AI, which stands for artificial intelligence, which has been in development for over 30 years. High-speed connectivity, which has been also in development for 30 years. We're now getting to the age of 5G, which promises unprecedented speeds of connection, but also zero, very, very little latency. An ability to obtain very high speeds almost at any distance. The cloud technologies, the ability to connect to an array of computers that are remote, that gives you incredible storage capacity, but also incredible processing power. So you can connect very fast with 5G to those supercomputers, solve a problem that may be an AI problem and go back with you. And you're just using very little computing power to do it yourself by leveraging that. The mobile technologies are super accessible. Now the price keeps growing and the computing power keeps increasing. Robotics have gotten to a point, we're now calling this advanced robotics. Where robots can do things they could never do, they can actually think and move. And then we have a whole new generation of visualization tools in XR, extended reality, which includes virtual reality, augmented reality, mixed reality. So all of these are getting to a point that allows us to combine them at very little cost and solve very important and complex problems that we were unable to solve before. And that's what we call the fourth and newest technology revolutions, is the revolution of solving significant and complex problems we're going to be able to do now. So let me show you some examples. Because of my travels, and unfortunately today this is limited, but we'll still get to see a lot of very interesting things. I'm going to give you some examples. The first one is from a company called Neon, which is a subsidiary of Samsung, the Korean company that develops the TVs and the smartphones. The goal of Neon is to create artificial humans. This was presented in CES 2020. The largest technology conference in the world is in Las Vegas, and I was in attendance this past January. So let me show you the examples. So this example, you see the person, the image of the person with fully digitally rendered human, and you can see down here the code that is creating those expressions. And here, this is a console of expressions. Some of them are like serious, some smiling, and so on. As the user is changing the expressions, you can see how it goes from one expression to the next, and you see the avatar smiling. The second sample, you see a different avatar. The first one looked more like a flight attendant. This second one is more like a punk rock and roll friend, if you have. And again, fully digitally rendered. And I zoomed in on some of the behavioral expressions and how they were moving. And then when I zoom into the face, you can see the imperfections still, and this is a system that they say it's not even in beta. It's so new that it's not even in beta, but you can see how they how really where it's going. These screens were about my height and not very tall, but it was human size. And it's a platform, so you can connect this to other platforms, like a translation engine, like a search engine, and then it can become a digital assistant. And it can even, if it has a translation engine, you can speak in one language and it could go find that and speak you back in a different language if you need to. So all kinds of applications that you could have with this. We don't know when this will be commercially available, but it's incredibly powerful to see it. There was a camera mounted also, so be able to track the movements of the person in front to feed that also to the avatar. The second example is a robotics example. So you guys remember I told you about my first interview, my first job, and about this guy, Andy. So see, this is what he does now. So he's a computer animator, and he really likes industrial robots. Now, industrial robots are this very machine that does a very specific task, which is to try to do the same thing over and over and over again for a very long period of time with a very small margin of error. And a robotic arm like this one has six different freedom axes, and they're mostly used in manufacturing to have manufacturing lines and have the robots do very specific tasks, like putting screws in or putting a doors in a car and things like that. But as an animator, and he's a guy that thinks very differently, he thought, well, yeah, it's that, but it's also a very simple rig. For animation, if I could take this model into a computer animation software, I can make it do different movements. And I could attach to the front of it different devices like a screen or something else. And then if I have a screen, not only will I be animating what's inside the screen, I can animate the screen itself and turn it to a different kind of entertainment and create pre-done animations that he calls choreography. So it's a very interesting use of that technology. He wrote software that will create an interface between the computer animation software and the language that the robots can understand, because the robots really utilize a very low level kind of programming language that is not very easy to do. It's more like a rotate this much, go down this much, and things like that. It's not something you cannot create fluidity with that. So he was able to create fluidity by creating an interface between the computer animation software and the robots. And this video is very, very interesting for that. So, you know, these applications in the video is mostly for entertainment, and is a very cool application of using robotics. But there are other scientific applications to it. You could see in it, one of his biggest clients that's using the software by using robots in their events is Royal Caribbean, which is one of the largest operators of cruises in the world. And they have them as part of their main show when you're in those cruises. But in order to have that, it was a very important problem that needed to be solved when you have a robot in a factory, but the ground is not moving. So that robot can do what it needs to do. But when you put that robot to operate in a boat, in a ship, now because that is floating, the ground now on that robot is moving. So in order to make that work, they have to write additional software to solve the problem of the fact that the robot is sitting on ground that is moving. Because they solved that problem, then, and there was a very small portion of that case that showed it, but the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, which is one of the very important divisions of NASA, the Space Administration in the United States, had a mission in which they were sending a rocket to an asteroid, and with a mechanical arm, they needed to pick up samples of rock samples from the asteroid, and they haven't solved the problem of putting the mechanical arm in a surface that where the ground is moving, which is what happens when you land in an asteroid. So they end up contacting him and using his software for that NASA mission. So you can see how he solved a problem for a particular case, but then that can be applied to something entirely different. Very, very important. In this case is another example of advanced robotics. And now what happens when the robot can actually think? Then you can have all the kinds of applications. In the case of Andy, the robot is just performing choreographies. It's pre-made. It's not reacting. Now, there's a company here in the United States called Boston Dynamics, and you probably have seen some of their videos from time to time going on the internet, and you see robots doing very amazing things, human-like, animal-like. And they've been working in trying to get robots to move more like organic beings for a very long time. That is because we humans and even animals have the ability to move to terrain a lot easier. We're a lot more flexible. So if you want to send a robot to a tragic area, to some disaster area, it's not easy for a robot with the traditional technology to climb through that, to climb through it, and they can fall off and they can't get up again. Whereas if you send a dog, the dog can easily go all around, or a human can do that. So replicating that requires a lot of artificial intelligence and cameras and sensors, all kinds of things. So they've been working in this robot called Spot, that is kind of like a dog, and it can collaborate, and it can think, and can avoid its collision. And they recently released it for public use and for commercial use, along with that SDK, a series of software libraries, so you can program it. And this is a commercial that they released with that back in, I think, in February. It can go to different terrains, it can collaborate, it can do a bunch of things. Today, they're even looking into adding them to hospitals to be able to help with the patients by carrying some of the physical things that doctors need to get to the patients. So let me show you the commercial. So how about that? It's just, it's a little scary even the time, but he comes back and opens the door for the other one. And then he's able to, when he run out of power, to activate the next one to go, and the one can work. So you can think of a million applications of the kind of robotics, and it is now commercially available. You can buy it and program it yourself. All right, the next technology that I think is really interesting from a company called Magic Leap. And you probably see later that they've been going through some economic problems, and that is true, but the technology they have developed, I think, is gonna prevail at the end. So let me explain it. So we have virtual reality, which is you get some goggles and you can't really see anything. And it's what we call full immersion. And but there's also another kinds of reality called augmented reality, which you get with your phone, and like Pokemon Go, you start looking at the real world, and you can see through that screen things that are not really there. You can only see them through the screen. That's called augmented reality. And then there's another kind where you use goggles or glasses like the one I'm wearing, although these don't have that technology. These are normal glasses. But you can imagine that instead of the full immersion, I can get normal glass and I can see through. And when I can see through, then there's a whole other dynamic, because I'm not gonna run into things. But the technology these guys develop have cameras and lasers that are projecting to your retina. So just like you do the augmented reality with the phone, when everything is appearing in the screen, this everything appears in your own eyes, and by projecting to them and combining the external reality with the additional reality that you are doing, and they call this mixed reality. But Magic Leap takes this principle, taking one step ahead, and it's also with the cameras and sensors, it can map the room. And I know that a wall is a wall and that table is a table. And why that matters is because then it can interact with the room in the virtual world combining with the real world. What I mean by that is, let's say that I have a virtual ball that doesn't exist. That I grab it with my goggles on, my glasses on, and then I grab it with my hand and I drop it. And if the space doesn't know, if the device is not aware of the space, and that ball is gonna go through the table because it doesn't know that it's there. In the technology of Magic Leap, it will know that that table is there. It will bounce and all kinds of things. So when I first used that technology, I put some fish in the air and they were swimming, and then I went to do something else. When I went to find the fish, I couldn't see them anymore, and they were under the table. So I don't know they're under the table. And I'm like, and because I was looking down at the table, the surface of the table could not let me see. But then I had to kind of lean down and I went under to watch, and I saw the fish swimming under the table. And you can only do that if the device is aware of the space. So they call this a spatial computer. So here's one example of one of what they can do. Okay.
We'll be right back.
The applications in the video are more for gaming, but you can see how you could use this in manufacturing, in other environments where you walk into something and it knows what kind of machine it had in you. I mean, you need additional training, we'll do that, or we'll tell you what's inside without having to go in, and or for training for doctors or first responders, all kinds of, because you can see through, you can apply the virtual world anywhere, and because you know the space, there's a whole series of things that you can do. It's very, very interesting. I want to close with a video, some examples of what our technology students at FullServe have been able to do over the years. Most of these have to do with having platforms, prototypes with different input devices to move them and apply it into games. These prototypes eventually do make it into a full-size platform that we have a full cell, but it gives you an idea of what kind of projects our students are working on. Okay, so this concludes my presentation for today. I just wanted to leave you with this last message. As you can tell from everything that we presented today, even though technology have come a very long way, there is so much that we can do. And what I get most excited about folks that could be joining us in the technology world now is that if you choose to do that, you got a unique opportunity that those before didn't, you don't have. You get to build on top of 50 years of innovation that is successful for you, where you can then apply it towards solving very important problems for the world. And as I said before, we're not on a lack of problems that are complex and difficult, but also super important. So come and join technology, be part of the fourth revolution, and make a very big difference. So I'd like to part thanking you for your time and watching this video and asking Carol if she can tell which one of those three.
Now I know you are the one using the Armada shirt.
There you go, the Armada shirt. So it would be this guy right here. And it's easy to confuse me because in this one, my brother is half the beard and I don't. So it's easy to get confused. Well, thank you so much, Carol, for this opportunity.
Thank you, Luis. Bye-bye.